entitled the motion, study of the book of Exodus, here in Exodus 21:12-21, with the title Criminal Law and Death Penalty. So we are trying to make sense of this laws that God has given to the nation of Israel, and we try to understand it in the context of modern legal codes. And we began last week when we said that there are four general categories. Under public law, you have civil government, military laws, court, and legal procedures. And under private law, you have civil law and criminal law. And criminal law is where we are going to, where this text is going to be classified. Religious law, national duties and prohibitions, individual conduct, humane laws, the fourth one, duties towards persons and kindness to animals. Exodus 12-21 is classified under section 1 of private law in the subsection criminal law, which is the second section under civil law, under crimes against persons. So it's the fourth subsection, the introduction note, crimes and their punishments, crimes against public, crimes against morality, and this one, crimes against persons. And the subsection there is manslaughter. Exodus 21:12-13, 20-21. He that smiteth a man so that he die shall be surely put to death. And if a man lie not in wait, but deliver him into his hand, then I will appoint thee a place whither he shall flee. So if it's a clear case where the intent of murder is known, then the killer, the murderer, shall surely be put to death. But if he has not intentionally killed the person, it was not his intent, right? There was no malice in it, then you find that it's classified here under manslaughter. And here the text says that if a man lie not in wait, means that he does not have the intention to murder someone, but God delivered him into his hand, meaning that he was caught, then I will appoint thee a place whither he shall flee. So here it is said that such a man who committed what we said today, manslaughter, would be given a refuge, a place of safety. And later on, you will see God giving Moses God appointing cities of refuge. And this will be more clearly discussed and stated during the book, during the time of Joshua, when Israel would have entered the promised land. God would instruct Joshua to assign certain cities designated in the land whereby this man could flee to. These are called cities of refuge. But for all intent here, we are going to focus about what this law means. Okay, so if a man smite his servant or his maid with a rod and he die under his hand, he shall be surely punished. Notwithstanding, if he continue a day or two, he shall not be punished, for he is his money. So here is spoken of one who beats his servant, and if he dies, then he is culpable. But if he did not die, then he will not be punished with death. Okay. Then under the section J, B is manslaughter. Section J, miscellaneous crimes punishable by death. And it's interesting here, cursing of father and mother. Cursing of father and mother is a crime punishable by death. And that is quite, in a sense, if you think of it from God's perspective, in the mind of God, it is actually quite quite serious. In the mind of God, the violation of the fifth commandment, honor thy father and thy mother, is a serious, in Israel's law, a crime punishable by death. So here is given the law in Exodus 21 verse 15, he that smiteth his father or mother shall be surely put to death. Verse 15, and also verse 17. Okay? And this punishment, as you think of it, you would see the significance of it. When we were mentioning about the fifth commandment, two Bible studies earlier, we mentioned about the fifth commandment, how the fifth commandment is so important, because a man who knows how to honor father and mother would know how to honor God, because they are the representatives of God. And if they learn how to honor father and mother, then you would find that they would also be able to honor authority, because the parents are the immediate authority to them. And so here it is also classified under part 3 in the section called rebellious son, and the verse in Deuteronomy in Exodus 21:15 is again quoted. He that smiteth his father or his mother shall be surely put to death. So the rebellious son in the sight of God, rebellion in the sight of God is very serious. It's a crime punishable by death. So here, verse 21 of Deuteronomy, of chapter 21 of Deuteronomy, verses 18 to 21 also highlights this and elaborates. It says here, if a man have a stubborn and rebellious son, which will not obey the voice of his father or the voice of his mother, and that when they were chased, they have chastened him, will not hearken unto them, they discipline him, then his father and his mother lay hold on him and bring him unto the elders of his city and unto the gate of his place, and they shall say unto the elders of the city, this our son is stubborn and rebellious, he will not obey our voice, he is a glutton and a drunkard, and all the men of the city shall stone him with stones that he die. So shalt thou put evil away from among you, and all Israel shall hear and fear. So the parents has this grave responsibility that such a son will not, in a sense, cause mayhem in general in society. And parents are to deal the punishment through the procedure in their respective place of lodging. They are both to the leaders in the city, the judges in the city, to try such a one. Okay. Then you also see stealing and selling men. Okay. Stealing and selling men. This one is kidnapping, extortion, and all this. Okay, very serious. Okay, very serious. And he that stealeth a man and selleth him, or he be found in his hand, he shall surely be put to death. Deuteronomy 24, verse 7. If a man be found stealing any of his brethren of the children of Israel, and maketh merchandise of him, or selleth him, then that thief shall die, and thou shalt put evil away from among you. So if you think about the crime that the sons of Jacob committed against their brother Joseph, you see that it falls into that category. And within the family, all the more, right, they have blood relations, and yet the hatred is so great. Now we're going to speak a little bit about this law. This section addresses the application of the law in the violation of the sixth commandment. The sixth commandment, thou shalt not kill. The sixth commandment is the shortest statement in the table of the Ten Commandments, written exactly in both texts. Exodus 20 verse 13 and Deuteronomy 5 verse 17, and it is written with just two words, and a negative particle, a negation, as a statement of fact. Why is this commandment given? It is a commandment given to safeguard the sanctity of life. You go to Deuteronomy chapter 9, verses 4 to 6. God gave the law concerning the sanctity, the preciousness of human lives. We know that man is made in the image of God, sacred. But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, ye shall not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require, at the hand of every beast will I require, at the hand of men, and at the hand of every man's brother will I require the life of man. Whosoever sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. For in the image of God made he man. So God gave this reason, right, that the life of another human being is sacred in the sight of God. Okay? You cannot do what you like. Okay? Because God is the one who make each one special, sacred. You cannot do what you like to another human being. So the death penalty is a part of this sixth law, so that it is no murder to take life on God's terms and under his law. The terms are established by God, and God as the giver of life establishes the laws for all of life and all things else. So God is the one who gives this lives and the system, the ecosystem of human existence, and therefore he is the enactor and the judge for this. So a man must not only avoid committing murder and seek the apprehension of a murderer, but he must also seek the death penalty for murder. This is what God says in this law. We are here, we see here that the protection and nurture of man's life under God is the positive of affirmation of this sixth commandment. So, thou shalt not kill. And what does it mean in reality for us? And what does it mean in truth, in the application for this law? Is that the life of man is to be considered sacred. So we see that our civil laws are closely linked to the laws of God. As our late Reverend told, Timothy Jones observed, he said that Singapore law is taken from Indian law, Indian law from British law, and British law from Roman law, and Roman law from God's law, as summarized in the Ten Commandments. So we see here there is a respect for life that is required in this commandment. Not reverence for life, but reverence for God and His law is basic to this and every other commandment. So we were studying the book of Proverbs, and the Proverbs teaches us that the first, the beginning of wisdom comes to a man who fears God. And what does it mean to fear God? This is what it means, a reverence for God and His laws. A reverence for who God is. He's the giver and enactor of all these things. So all the commandments hinge upon observing the first commandment. It is thereby against the law to put anyone or anything before God. Life cannot be placed before God, neither our life or any man's life. So when God says no, it is no. So in a society where capital punishment is enforced, you will find that there is civil order. When capital punishment is lifted, you will see that there will be chaos. Where do you keep all those criminals, these murderers? They escape, well, it will be a great danger to society at large. Psalm 82 verses 2 to 4. How long will he judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked? Defend the poor and fatherless, do justice to the afflicted and needy, deliver the poor and needy, rid them of the hand of the wicked. So, you know, the law of God teaches us to uphold, defend the helpless. So it is also against this sixth commandment to take one's own life. So as you think about this sixth commandment, we are also considering as a corollary someone who would commit suicide. It's a violation of the sixth commandment. God's plan is for life, not death. So the Bible teaches that both physical and spiritual death is a result of our sin and disobedience to God, but eternal life is a gift to those who received it. So last week, he said to the man before he went home to be with the Lord, and to many of the friends that came, he said that if you know Jesus Christ, He saved you from the punishment of eternal death. You don't know God. If you don't know Jesus Christ, you die. You would suffer eternal separation from God. Eternal separation from God. And that is, that eternal separation means eternal punishment in hellfire. But because God loved us, therefore He did not want us to be eternally separated from Him. And the law, the order of the day, or the order of the universe is that if a man takes his last breath and he dies, then he faces either eternal life or eternal death. And so God's way out of man's conundrum, death conundrum, is that God sent His Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is God's solution to man's sin or death problem. And all who would believe what Jesus Christ has done on the cross, He shed His blood, washed away our sins, and He is that sacrifice for sin, for us, we shall be saved. And the Lord loved us, or God loved us more than any one of our friends loved us. Our love for each other may be very intense, but be very strong, but cannot be compared with God's love for us. How God loved us is that He bare the penalty for our sins. He died for us, in other words. Paid the penalty for the consequence of sin. God, you know, that for every sin, there is a consequence. For every crime, there is a consequence. Okay? This is the law of sowing and reaping. Right? You do this, there is a certain consequence to your actions. So we are saying that sin has its consequence. And the consequence of sin is death and judgment in hellfire. And so, in order to escape that consequence, God sent His Son in order to die for us. And we cannot in any way work to win this salvation, to save ourselves. God is the one who enacted for us. And we are to receive it by faith, to receive what Jesus Christ has done to save us from the penalty of eternal death. So, the Lord wants us to see and understand that this law that is given to us ought to be understood in this way. Right? This man called Rush Dooney, in the book The Institutes of Biblical Law, he wrote this. The law asks two things of a man. He says, obedience and enforcement. So obedience is for yourself, and enforcement is for others. To obey a law means, in effect, to enforce it in one's own life and in one's community. God's law is not a private matter. It is not for us to obey personally simply because we like it, meanwhile leaving other men to follow whatever law they choose. The law is valid for us because it is valid for all. To obey it means to accept a universal order as binding on us and upon all men. Obedience, therefore, requires that we seek a total enforcement of the law. And so, as you look at these laws that were given here in verse 12 to 21, it is a commandment for law and order, so that children will learn how to honor their parents. The master learn how to honor their servants, and one man learn to honor the life of another man. Okay. So this is the gist of what we are saying here. So as we read this commandment, we are to understand that law and order are the responsibilities of all good men without exception. It says, injuries to our fellow men or to our enemies, which are not subject to civil or criminal action, are still our responsibilities. For example, our police power involves action against backbiting or tail-bearing. It also requires that we, in love of our neighbor, have a regard to their property as well as his reputation to avoid injury to it. So here, when we talk about murder, we are not talking about, you know, just simply murder per se, right? But here, if you injure the good name of another person, right, here you're also culpable. Okay? So the first covenant home set up by Adam and Eve was devastated when one sibling killed the other. Cain killed Abel. Cain was the first male child to be born on earth. First child. Okay. The Bible says Cain was very angry, very wroth. And what happened? He was very upset with the brother because the brother gave God-honoring sacrifice, whereas his was not according to God's order. He violated God's order, but his brother followed the order of God, and he was angry with his brother for following the order of God. And he was angry and he murdered the brother. And so here, we not only speak about actual action, but the spirit of it. Okay? A hatred in the heart spells the beginning of trouble. Okay? So we say also that verse 12 to 14 gives to us the intent for murder. Here is given in the law to ascertain the intent of the person accused for murder. If one murders in cold blood, he is culpable and he shall pay for the murder with his own life. But if the killing was not premeditated, there was no intent to kill, then he shall be allowed to flee to one of the cities of refuge that shall be set up when they enter the land, so that this may find refuge. We spoke about it earlier, manslaughter. And in the pulpit commentary here is said well. Here again, in the time of Moses, a custom regarded as of absolute obligation upon all held possession of the ground, and nothing was practicable but some modification of it. The next of kin was avenger of blood and was bound to pursue every homicide to the bitter end, whether it was intentional or premeditated. or hastily in a quarrel, or wholly unintentional. So here it is explained to us why a place of refuge is needful. Okay? The thought here is that anyone who has his close relative murdered, whether it is for whatever reason, it is in the nature of man, fallen man, to seek revenge, to retaliate. Okay? So this law is to protect. It's to protect man when he is angry, not to do what he ought not to do. So Moses distinguished between deliberate murder, which the state was to punish capitally, verses 12 to 14, and any other sort of homicide, which is left to the adventure of blood. In mitigation of the blood feud, he interposed the city of refuge. I didn't put in the notes the picture of the cities, because they haven't entered the land yet. Okay? So God has just given them the laws, and this would form the basis by which they would put together a constitution for the order of the Jewish society, and they would enter the promised land. So this is where we will stop today. Lord, help us. Let us pray. Father, we thank thee for guiding us to examine these verses that shows to us crimes against persons, and shows to us the needful redress that ought to be taken. Lord, we thank thee for showing us how we ought to behave, how we ought to act according to what would be equitable laws and judgments that we ought to do. Lord, thank thee for giving to us thy laws. Instruct us with thy wisdom how we ought to order our lives. May your mind be our mind. As I pray with thanksgiving, in Jesus' name. Amen.